In today's video, I want to show you how I get hexies on a background without doing any hand stitching. Hi, I'm Kim Jamison Hurst of Chatterbox Quilts. I'm a quilting teacher, and I'm also the creator and host of The Quilter's Way. It's an online quilting club where quilters learn and grow in a fun and supportive community. Now, if you want to learn more about The Quilter's Way, just go to thequiltersway.com. Before we get into the hexie subject today, I would love it if you'd subscribe to my channel and hit the bell so you'll be notified the next time I release a new video. Today, I'm dealing with these hexies. Now, if you're not familiar with them, they're hexagon-shaped pieces of fabric. And typically, you make them by sewing them together, making different designs, by sewing them together by hand. So you do little tiny stitches in between them. Now, I gotta tell you, I've had these hexagons hanging around my studio for several years. And the reason I haven't done anything with them is because I really didn't want to hand stitch them together. I know, right? So I want to use my sewing machine to get these onto my background fabric. So I did do these by hand. I used cardstock in the center of them. I cut out the shapes from cardstock using one of my cutters that I have. I think one of my digital cutters actually is what I used for this. And I put them on and I did hand stitching around to just baste them in place. So that wasn't too bad. But the next step just seemed like too much work for me. So instead what I did is I took these fabric pieces, I took out the cardstock from them, and I ended up with this. Now, I've only done enough here to show you the demo, but the rest are, I'm going to do the same thing with them. So what I've got here is these pieces, and I starched them heavily so that they will hold their shape so I can work with them. They're not stiff as a board, but they've definitely kept their edges there, so that's really what I want. And then I've got my background fabric, and I want to center this. I'm going to make like a traditional grandmother's flower. It's what I want to make here. And so I folded my background fabric into quarters to give me some registration marks. Let me just move my pressing mat over because we're going to be pressing here. I don't want to just press on my tabletop here. So here's my background square, and I've got all these pieces. Now, I want them to look like this when I'm done. I want to have my little yellow center here for my flower, and then I alternate my pink and blue around that center. So this is what they're going to look like. Roughly. Okay, so it makes a nice little flower. So to do this, as I said, I need to make sure that these pieces are down on my background fabric first before I start sewing them. And they only need to be held temporarily. So what I decided I would use is some seam aligned glue. Now you could use a glue stick if you wanted to, but I love using this product. So what I did was, I've got these registration marks. I'm taking my center piece and I'm folding it in half and just giving it a little bit of a finger press there. You can use your nail a little bit just to give me a registration line there. Okay, for my vertical line there. My horizontal line, I'll be matching it up with the little points on either side. Okay, so that's great. Now what I want to do is I want to hold that in place so it doesn't move. And I want to add some seam aligned glue. And this is just little dots you need. You don't need a lot of this. Just putting a few little dots on to hold it in place. It's heat activated. So I'll just put it down there, and then I'm going to use my iron to press it down. Just a dry iron, and just maybe 5 seconds, something like that. Just enough to keep it down there. Okay, so it's stuck to my fabric. And then I'm going to do the same thing, of course, at the bottom to get the other half of it down. I love this applicator tip. It just puts a little tiny bit of the product on your fabric. You don't need a whole bunch that's all over the place making a mess on your background fabric. Just enough to hold it down. All right, now that I've got my center piece in place, all I have to do is add my other little pieces around it. So I am going to use my seam aligned glue on the back of these to put them all down around the center block, and then I'll be able to go to my sewing machine and show you how I stitch them down. I'm at the sewing machine, and before I actually get to stitching this, I just wanted to talk to you a little bit about the difference in the look you're going to get when you're using your sewing machine. Typically, when you put these hexagons together, you're striving to get a I can't see the stitches look. When I'm using my sewing machine, you're going to see the stitches. As a matter of fact, I've got a thicker weight thread in here. I'm using a white thread, so you will actually see the stitches when I stitch on here. Now, part of that I'm doing for demonstration purposes. I typically would not use that thick of thread, but no matter what color thread I'm using, I'm going to see it if I'm doing a zigzag stitch. If you don't want to see the thread, you could use a monofilament, and that would help to, make them disappear a little bit. And you could also use a blanket stitch if you want to. As I said, I'm going to use a zigzag stitch today, so you would see more of that than probably a blanket stitch. But I just wanted to make you aware that it's going to look a little different than you might expect it to. Before I started stitching these today, or before I start stitching these today, I actually practiced my stitches because I actually changed the length and the width of the default on the zigzag stitch I'm using on this machine. You may be okay with the default on your machine, you may not, so it's a good idea to check it out first. The other thing is, you typically want to try and figure out the path that allows you to continuously stitch as much as possible. I'm not good at that, I'll admit that right now, but what I think I'm going to do is I think I'm going to go around the center first, because that'll attach everything together and hold it in place. I mean, it's already held in place, as you can see, with that seam-aligned glue. But after I go through the center, my next thing that I will do, my next stitching, is to go up and around and down, and then I will have to break my thread, and then I will do the same thing with each of these, and that will get it all done. So let's start in the center there. And the zigzag stitch I'm using here will start in the middle, and the stitches will go to either side. I have different options on this Janome M7. That's what I'm going to try and do. So let me just see here. We'll see how this goes, because I'm going to have to stop and turn corners and things like that, right? So let's just take it slow. Because I'm going to want to turn here, see what I can do. Okay, now you don't want to go that fast. This is definitely a slow procedure, because when you start going too fast, you make mistakes. And that's what I've done here. I've gone along and I've actually come off my seam, and I'm only going mostly on the center block. So you definitely want to slow down when you're doing this process. So you can see the stitches on this, right? Whereas typically you wouldn't. So it's going to depend on whether you like that look or not. The next thing I need to do, of course, is to go around and finish all the rest of them. So I'll do that, and then I'll come back and show you what it looks like. Now I've finished this whole flower, and you can really see the stitches, of course. As I said, I used a heavier thread. One of the things you might have noticed is that I've switched feet partway through. I started off with my AD foot on the Janome M7, which is an AccuFeed Flex foot, or like a walking foot, to move it along, but I was finding I was having difficulty seeing the stitches as I was making them, and I want to make sure I can move around these points. So I actually switched to my F2 foot, which is an open toe applique foot, so that gave me much better visibility as I was going along. So, if you're doing something, you're finding it's not working, or you want to try another foot, might work better, don't be afraid to experiment. So I like how this turned out. It saved me a lot of time, for sure. And as I said, I could use a thread that blends better, or even a monofilament thread, if I didn't really want to see those stitches going around. So if you haven't tried hexies by hand, because like me, you didn't want to spend the time, or take the time, I should say, to do it, and you were afraid your stitches might not be as good as you would hope they would be, why not try it by machine? And as I said, you can use a zigzag stitch, or try a blanket stitch too, and you won't see quite as much thread on your project. I hope you liked today's video. If you did, give it a thumbs up and be sure to share it with your quilting friends. And if you'd like more helpful quilting information, go to my website at www.chatterboxquilts.com.